In this video, we'll learn about databases, what they are, how they work, and how to access them. First, we'll define a database. Next, we'll explore what a simple database looks like on the inside. Then, we'll look at some databases that you're probably already familiar with to compare and contrast how similar they are to the library's databases. Finally, we'll look at the A to Z database list and learn how to access and sort through the library's databases. A database is a storage place for information, and that information has been organized in a logical way with searchers in mind. The information contained in databases is organized using what are called records. To illustrate that, a business might hire you to create a database in order to keep track of their customers. Each customer would have its own full record of information about them. First name, last name, how long they've been a customer, and maybe their location and contact information. Each customer has the same set of organized information. Having the information organized in this way allows you to run a very quick search in your database of thousands of customers. You could have it display only the customers in Texas, or only customers named Steve, or something more complex, like only customers in Texas who've also been customers for more than 1 year. So because this data has been organized into records in a database, the business is able to build complex search queries and receive answers quickly and accurately. We'll talk more about records and constructing searches in another video. Now that we've looked inside a simple database, let's turn to the outside, how they appear, and are organized for users and researchers. Databases aren't just for businesses or computer programmers. There are some databases that you probably use every day that operate in a similar way to the library's databases. If you use Netflix or Disney Plus, you're using a database. It may help to think about it like this. You or someone in your family probably subscribe to a streaming service like Netflix. Netflix, in exchange, allows you to access a rotating selection of movies and TV shows. Inside a season of a TV show, there are individual episodes that you can choose to watch. As you search through Netflix, its goal is to keep you on its service, watching something, anything, for as long as possible. Bracket Library subscribes for you to a database like PsycINFO. PsycINFO, in exchange, allows you to access a stable selection of scholarly journals. Inside a journal, there are individual articles, often available as PDFs, that you can choose to download and cite as sources for your paper. As you search through PsycINFO, its goal is to help you sort through its offerings as quickly and efficiently as possible. If you take the time to master the search features that academic databases provide, you can spend less time researching and more time watching Netflix or going outside and being a person. Just as you might subscribe to more than one video streaming service in order to access more shows and movies, the library subscribes to many databases on your behalf to give you access to a huge selection of academic journals. Click A to Z database list to see all of the databases that Bracket Library subscribes to. Here they're listed alphabetically. Some databases include a wide variety of journals that publish on all manner of subject areas. Academic Search Complete, ProQuest Central, and JSTOR are good examples of these broader types of databases. Other databases are much more specialized. PsycINFO, that we talked about earlier, is home to a massive amount of journals dedicated to the behavioral sciences. Before moving on to the next video, be sure to take a few minutes to sort the databases by subject to see which ones might be good matches for your major for when you begin to do more upper-level research. If you're taking English 1110 or English 2110, start with the Academic Writing and Research grouping. It's a broad selection of databases that cover a lot of topics you'll be writing about in these classes. The interfaces of some of these databases may look very similar, but if they're called by a different name, they are providing access to different journal collections. For example, PsycINFO, Academic Search Complete, and ERIC are all databases we subscribe to from a company called EBSCO. So the interface for these databases is similar for all of the EBSCO databases. You can always keep track of what database you're in by looking right here. This might be helpful if you have a lot of tabs open on your browser. Databases from a company called ProQuest share this type of interface. And JSTOR does its own thing too. You may have noticed this big search box on the main page of the library. This is not a database that the library subscribes to. This is a kind of meta search engine called a discovery tool. It searches through many of our databases at the same time as well as our library catalog. We'll look more closely at this tool in some later videos, but we generally recommend that you search individual databases, especially when you're looking for articles. When you finish watching this series of videos, you'll have the tools you need to construct search terms, choose a database, and navigate it, no matter what the interface looks like.